Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I call to order our special city council meeting of September 30th. We have one item on the agenda, and that is the discussion of our fiscal 2017 budget. I'll turn it over to Kim and other staff at this point.
Okay. What you have in your packet is what we're going to go over are the operating budgets. So we're going to go over the general fund, GPWA, fire, and airport. I also included capital projects because we're going to be crossing over as we go through the budgets, and with some recommendations of moving some things from the operating budget over to capital projects. I do want to start off with the general fund, this cover sheet that shows what in this entire packet, it also shows what was actually originally requested from all departments. And then that would be the second column to the right, and then what was actually adopted. And so you'll see that when, after receiving all of the requests, we started at $2.2 million over what we had projected in revenue. And so that's when we started going through each of the departments. And we also started looking at the revenue and adjusting them accordingly. So from 2.2 million, we were able to go down to a balanced budget, but that also includes, and if you look at your screen, this balanced budget also includes, $548,508 of fund balance. In my email to you, I had recommended some changes to that we could move some things that are budgeted in the operating budgets over to capital projects that would reduce this by about $250,000, or that would leave $250,000 still in the fund balance. But as we go through this, we can start with general government, and we can kind of walk through each department to show what was actually requested. General government, this department is actually a centralized expenditure fund that covers supplies, covers things that all departments use. And you'll see that what was originally requested.
What page are we on here?
We're going from the first page. We're just turning over to
general government. Right?
General government.
The fourth page.
Right here. This is 16103 is the first item.
So at the bottom, you'll see that what was originally requested, or what was originally funded, was $5.6 million worth of expenditures. And once it was all said and done, it actually was $6.7 million.
Can you clarify what page it is?
Yeah, I'm not
right.
I'm
you sorry. Were at 6110, item 6110. We are right
oh,
here.
Oh, over here now.
This is where we in materials and supplies is where they were. And now we're at the end of total government. The next page, 6 million.
Okay. Hard to follow.
Propose. $110,000. Mm-hmm. 1.1 over.
I
was just trying to get full screen.
I know.
I'm gonna catch up, it moves.
Are we all on the same page?
Yep.
Department number 010100, right?
Yes. Yes. Okay. In this budget. The transfer, I know that some people or some of you have asked questions what that transfer is, that transfer in and transfer out. It is, it's related to the, for instance, the sales tax amendment that we just passed and the money that we've borrowed. We're required by that agreement, we were required to transfer one penny over to GPWA. If it wasn't needed, we transfer it back. And that, so you'll see that transfer in to GPWA and you'll see it coming back. Well, with the new note that we have with Chase Bank with the $16 million, I think that we just borrowed around $16 million, that required us to send an additional 0.75 cent over to GPWA and then send it back. So that's why that's increased so much, is it's 1.75% versus 1%. We had originally thought that we were going to use the user fee in this year to pay off some of the loans that we have outstanding. And so that's why the capital projects at the bottom, we had originally had $46,000 in there that we would carry over. And that never happened. We never paid off any of those things. And so that's why it increased to a little over 100,000. The airport fund stayed the same. The increase in the sales tax is because we decided that with the tractor supply and the furniture store and some of the other things that were coming into town, we decided to raise our projected sales tax from let me look. I don't even remember what we had originally requested, but we raised it to 6 million. And so that's the reason why that increased to 1.2 million. That 1.2 million is going to be transferred over to the 0.75 cent sales tax, the capital projects fund. Trying to see some.
Say that one more time.
The $6 million that we have projected for sales tax, three quarter percent of it is going to be transferred over to the capital projects fund.
That's basically that 3/4 is the 1.2.
That's 1.2.
That is 3/4 of 1.2.
Uh-huh. The transfer to fire fund is based on their expenditures. And I'll have, when we get to fire fund, Eric can explain that. But that's how much the general fund transfers over to the fire fund. We send 1.3 million over there. This year that we're closing, we sent 1.17 million over. So it increased by, 200,000?
200,000.
Yeah.
So you'll be explaining that?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. The stabilization fund, which we would have had it fully funded this year, but we used around 65,000 of it to buy that land from the cemetery land, and so that's why you see a little bit going over to it next year. Those are the big things. Now, the small things up here are just normal. I say normal. Normal for us. If you have questions about some of the things that we fund out of this, let me know. There is an item that I've highlighted here in yellow. Some of the things that we're asking for can be and probably should be funded out of capital projects.
Where is that? That's somewhere else.
It's right here. It's under materials and supplies. 61.
Yeah, it is. Up at the top, and it's carpet for City Hall, tile for the police department, a carpet cleaner, tent. I mean, these are capital improvement items for this building, and so we would move about $60,000 from that line item over to capital projects, and that would help with our fund balance here. That would be one recommendation. If that is something that you as a council want to see us do.
And what is that line?
Buildings and grounds.
60. It's probably closer to 70.
Is it?
It is. Yeah. They've got little notes on each one of those that we don't have.
Yeah. So are you saying that all of that 93,000 that's on that building and grounds would be more appropriately out of the capital improvement?
Not all of it. Not all of it. Some of that is just maintenance that takes place, and Jim can explain some of that. But around 60, 65,000 of it can be moved over to capital projects.
Which, as Kim said, would be new carpeting for City Hall, putting new flooring down in the police department, and some things to the windows, putting a film on the windows for heat conservation and that type of thing.
And this would still happen if we move it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
New carpet is not normal maintenance?
No, because of the cost.
No, I mean, that you expect to replace the carpet so often.
Yeah. About around here.
I can tell you, we put it in our budget every year, and it's one of the first things that gets cut. Yeah. Yeah.
I'm not saying we don't need it. I'm just wondering if it shouldn't be, if it's not right there. I don't know.
Kim, I do have one question before we move any further and get any more involved. Would you please educate me on why we're paying FICA and Medicare out of general fund when there's no salaries or wages paid?
Well, this is new this year. Randall's salary and the judge. The judge was in my budget, and Randall came out of the city manager's budget. And the city manager wanted to move those into general government because he wanted to reflect what finance actually cost and what his office actually cost.
So they're not contracted by contract, they are employees, is that correct?
And so we move.
It's not then we move to the department out of which they're paid?
Well, that's how they were, and he had decided to move them out. And so we put it into this department.
So I wonder, as an audit question, I just wanted to know why we're should they not be associated
or attached and in the departments in which they should be funded from, or am I totally off the wall here?
I'm just questioning
yeah.
the decision to move them.
We really don't work for the city manager. We're really not in his department. We're kind of judge and our sort of friends because y'all employ us.
It is. It's in here.
Oh, it is.
Uh-huh. Yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah, it's at the top. It's actually, I have it listed as contract labor.
Okay.
Yeah.
Then I think it should be changed to salaries because if they're not contracted labor and we're paying FICA,
yeah,
that's my opinion that it should be moved into salaries.
And that happened because of an IRS ruling about 4 years ago that said I could no longer, and Jeff could no longer be independent contractor.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Is that not our choice.
No, and it's not, I mean, it doesn't really change, but I'm just moving from one line item to the other, so it doesn't change anything. So, no, that's not a big deal.
But for future reference and for audits, I'm wondering if that shouldn't be consistent.
And I can just move that right now.
Okay.
Consider
Thank
it
you.
Done. Yikes.
Yeah,
so 58 good. Goes to?
So it goes up to?
Salary.
Salary.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's probably where I should have put it in the first place. Yes, that was another change from in general government. We did move their salaries over to
okay,
this.
Well, that's fine. I'm mm-hmm. okay with that. I just felt like it should reflect what those FICA wages were for.
Are there any other line items that stick out to anyone that have you have any questions about?
Moment.
On this page, or are we
just
about
on
the whole thing?
Just on general government. On yeah, yeah.
I have a question on insurance premiums.
Uh huh.
So the requested was 341,000, and we only put in 290 is what we approved.
Mm-hmm.
And so is that a problem?
It's based off actuals. you know.
Are we underpaying the insurance premiums? Or?
No, I think what's happened in the process of the budget, we estimated back in July when we started this whole animal. And now we've gotten invoices for the next year. And so we're able to plug in, or Kim's able to plug
accurate.
In the accurate ones.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
So not a big deal. It's a good thing then.
It is. Because if, had we, you know, if we left it in kind of high, then we're cutting another department or another line item short.
Yeah, 16, that's like you estimated quite high.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, that's what it's going on.
What's the sales tax rebate?
That's for Love's. We agreed to pay them $150,000 over 5 years. So it's $30,000 a month or a year. Mm-hmm. And same with the furniture Galleria. I think it's up to 10,000. I don't.
So it's 30,000, but we're proposing 40. Are we looking at
plus Galleria?
The Galleria. Oh, Galleria. Yeah.
Okay. What about the trolley?
Yes, thank you. The trolley. This is something I don't know that I had this to maybe workshop with you at some time. Bruce had proposed funding, giving $45,000 to First Capital Charlie. We would need an agreement, of course, to be in place between the two entities, but I don't know if, I mean, that's something that should be discussed.
Is that something that did they come to us and they're broke, or what?
I don't know. I don't know about any conversations. Do you?
I can fill in a little of that. Most communities fund their mass transit. Edmond, Oklahoma City, they all do. Mm-hmm. We're one of the very few that do not, that has a major transportation network here, and Guthrie has not supported it, and that is why that this has been brought up. It was brought to the attention
of
the
city. Well, they lost their funding. They had state funding before.
Well,
it keeps
getting smaller and smaller because of the state crisis, so there is problems with that, so to keep... Yeah. A lot of people in town don't have transportation. It is pretty vital that we keep it viable here in Guthrie.
Well,
it is very well used.
I think that we need to have it, have them come in and have a workshop or something on it.
I think it'd be good. Yeah.
I can make that happen.
Okay. And I also...
Because I'd like to know their funding in the past years as well versus the $45,000 that we're proposing.
Okay. And it was also part of the survey, and I think public transportation was 21. I mean, it was kind of, it was on the list.
Well, if that was I do remember it being one of the items on the citizens' response when we were talking about the sales tax. So how do we, if in fact that is something that we want to use sales tax revenue for, how does the sales tax, which has all been moved to capital improvement, how does that pay for this, which is in
general? That's another question.
Yeah.
Big comment.
I mean, if it's something we can move, can we move that,
no.
Randall? No?
No, that's not a capital.
Okay.
Unless we bought service, I think. Mm-hmm. General government.
Yeah.
That wouldn't be a capital service?
No.
No.
So we have
first,
to
contract for them
yeah.
to not a capital item, but you can fund it out of general government. I mean, you've got other sales tax obviously besides the capital tax. You just can't fund it out of that. You can fund it out of the other sales tax.
But how do we make up that? How do we make up that account when the money that's going to it was a result of the sales tax being approved, number one. Number two, the citizens of the community saying public transportation is a priority.
Well,
so how do we make that happen?
You either have to make it up out of the general sales tax or you make it up out of fund balance this year. And those are the two methods.
Okay. I don't know the technicalities of that, but the intent, if the council agrees that we want to use some of the sales tax, 3/4 cent sales tax money to support public transportation is to pay for it out of that revenue source.
Well, I think I probably need to read the ballot title again, but generally a payment for a service to provide transportation is not a capital item, a capital or fixed assets. And that's not, by definition, that's not one. And that's not to say at some point if they need a trolley.
Trolley.
Purchase a trolley.
So we could purchase a vehicle, but not just give them X amount to facilitate their operating expenditures.
I'll say yes to that, but I do need to be out again because you're limited to what the voters approve as a capital tax. So we want to be real.
Sure.
Real strict in the interpretation.
All righty then. Randall's.
On that same page, you'll notice beautification, public enhancements. That was the downtown improvement project. It was being funded out of general government because that was where the sales tax, that's where we held the sales tax. That's now been moved to grant because of the TAP grant.
Hmm.
Any other questions on general government?
And that is that what is commonly referred to as the Mumford and Son monies?
Yes.
That's $218,000, right?
Yeah. And we're workshopping that, by the way, Tuesday night. Okay. The next budget is the city manager's budget. Really, the only thing that changed in this budget was moving Randall out of it.
Contemplating.
But do you have any questions with that?
No.
This would be the city manager and Andrea.
Okay, so just curious, is there any way you can save a little money by showing the car allowance for $6,000 as the way it was before? Because I'm not sure what the $2,400 extra was.
Yeah.
$700 is pretty pricey on a car allowance, my book.
Yeah.
Well,
both those two lines, car allowance and
technology.
Weren't there last year. How did he get there this year? We didn't put them in the contract.
He was getting a tech allowance.
Yeah, they are.
Yeah.
Both of them?
Yeah.
Or and they've been in every city.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Right, but
okay,
we can.
If you leave the 1,200 there just in case for the next one, but reduce that to six, I can't imagine why it should be 8,400.
I think that's even higher.
I think it is too.
Right, and that was $6,000.
It was what?
But he was proposing more.
Yeah, but
I haven't researched what it should be. 500 seems high too, but
well, it's certainly better than 80.
Better than 80.
Better than 80.
Yeah, it's better than 700 for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So.
Okay.
Salary down to about 60.
What's the professional development there for 5,000? What was that for?
Is that the manager's?
It is the manager's. It's training.
Yeah.
And if you look in 2014 and 2015, it's.
Was that the CNA that?
I think some of them went to ICMA, CMA, OML.
Now, has that included the mayor, too?
No. No. In fact, let's jump back over to general government real quick. Speaking of, we do have a line item for council travel. Which, where is it at?
Membership.
There it is. Yeah.
6314.
6314. You guys need to start going places. But you have $1,500 in there for FY17.
We budget something every year, but we don't always use it.
Right? No, no.
I think we're going to the Mayor's Congress in January.
We'll be in Tulsa.
Yeah.
We bumped that.
We just went to OML.
Just in case.
$5,000?
$1,500. No, the $1,500.
The $1,500.
Back to the $5,000. The year before, the estimate was $1,500. If, does that include dues for, like, the City Managers Association?
It does.
Okay. Isn't it, now, just asking you, is $5,000 accurate, or is that over budgeted?
It's probably high.
Well, I don't know. If you look at the last 4 years, they actually spent 4,500, 4,100.
Why is the estimate 1,500? Is that just what was used?
If that's all that was used, then let's pull it down to two or three.
But it was 40-some-hundred the years prior to him.
Yeah.
I think he just didn't do it.
Matt Mueller went
to us. 44, yeah. 41. Yeah.
Serena went places.
Serena did.
I think it's a good thing. Yeah, it's a good thing if you use it.
And you can think, I mean, if you have some, depending on when you hire, just for this budget year, depending on when you hire someone, you know, what time, I mean, what, if they have time to go places this year. I mean, if you're just looking at this year.
Yeah.
16, 17.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, I want to be fair, but I also don't want to over budget and make it there just, we have to spend this amount.
No, but I think that there, if you, in our past city, I think that is a good service to us for them going to those, so to those meetings, which Bruce didn't go to. Maybe you wasn't a member. Well, look at it. And being a member is good for us, I think.
And the previous managers used it, so I think, I'm hoping we find one, a manager who wants to use that money, so.
Believe it, okay.
Now, the question is the $1,500 enough on the council travel? I don't intend to travel, but is that enough for the mayor's stuff that we're doing and?
Has been.
Has been.
Has been.
Has been.
Okay.
Any other questions with the city manager? No. Human resources.
Well, then, that changed the bottom line of the city manager. We just saved $2,400.
This would be Jim's budget.
Why did the wages go down?
I can have him talk. I'm sorry. You go ahead.
I'm okay with you talking, but it's just Kathy, our payroll clerk, left us, and so then that got absorbed in the finance, and then that's the main thing. Right
okay.
There. And the part-time. I think
you had budgeted. I had included a part-timer trying to help Aaron with project work, type of thing. But,
not necessary? Okay. You're good with that, though. Okay, thank you.
And the line, oh, go ahead.
How do we go, Jim, from the $70,000 requested material supplies to $7,000?
Well, when that's requested, and we always ask for the moon and we get a piece of cheese. And we have a lot of equipment that I also am responsible, even though it says human resources, Aaron is in here as well, or GTE's playing. And so within that, the technology changes within the, you know, running a channel. And so we were looking at making a few upgrades. And so, you know, we'll just have to get by with what we got.
I can see that. Mm-hmm. Materials, that's what he's got on the screen.
Is he still in your department?
Yes, I think it's been revised, so yes.
Was there anything that's crucial? I mean, that's just absolutely necessary at this point in time?
Well,
I I'm going to ask a tough question.
Probably $7,000 gets us funded because of all the graphic stuff and all the software and all the things that we just do in order to maintain what we've got. And but it will be close. Like right now we're running on one, we have one camera that we use to run back and forth, you know, to like an airport board meeting, or if that camera goes out, they're $2,500, $3,000. If it goes out, we'll probably, I mean, we'll buy a new one, I'm sure. It's just, we'll be over budgeted. You know?
I'd rather put the $2,400 we saved on city manager car allowance into something that's really necessary.
I think Channel 20 is a big transparency issue that we need to deal with. So I think if we can, as long as it's Channel 20, right? Mm-hmm. Is we need to try to fund that if we can.
Now this line you're talking about is supplies, operating expenses, and these are specific to you, I take it, because we had general government, which is like paper and stuff that
is
everybody's.
Well, it's me and my department. Within my department is the Guthrie GTV 20.
Yeah, and I'm looking at those items up there. Those are technical items for General 20.
Yeah, those are all technical stuff, but what I guess my point is we already looked at general government and we had supplies and we were told that is what everybody uses, and it's like for everybody. All right, that what you said? Did I hear that wrong? When we were doing general government supplies, that was stuff that everybody uses.
Uh-huh.
Well, this is really specific to TV 20 and HR. These are really specific items.
Now, some of these items could be considered capital items. They are capital. I mean, they're improvements to GTV 20, to this room in particular.
Can we pull some of those out then?
Yeah.
And put them over? I think it's necessary. I think it's real important. I mean, how a large percentage of citizens know about it. And, I'm surprised when I went out walking my ward when I was running, in 2013 now? I was surprised how many people watch us on TV. So I think it's always important to keep that up and to enhance it. So if we can find ways to try to get, you know, maintain as much as we can of that, you know, we might have to cut some of it, but I think it's a benefit. So if we can move some of that to CIP.
I'd like to talk about the individual items requested before we just blanket and move it. For example, you got three cameras and accessories. What, for what?
Can Aaron, would Aaron know?
Can somebody speak
to
that?
Well, I can tell you, we have two. We're now down to one.
In here you're talking about?
No, no, I'm talking about a handheld camera that you can go around and take.
Okay.
Like the airport board meeting.
Like the airport meetings, and then we do a lot of remote shots. I mean, if you look at the latest chamber chats or the latest time with the mayor, or you know, we're shooting with two cameras. One of them's handicapped; it's being used, but its ability to work with files is gone. It's been burned out. So the thought process was, if we had an open, you know, if we can just go buy, you know, start afresh and buy, you know, this is our pie in the sky moon, like I say, and then you get the cheese. Well, it'd be great to have three digital cameras. It would also be great to have three digital cameras with
accessories.
Well, there's accessories, but we also included in there, and I'm having trouble seeing it, but wireless transmission kits, so that we could, it's a lot of money. $28,000.
So that's to stream it
that's just
right from the camera? Well, that's where your live stream
from
comes.
From the camera, then to the channel, then from the channel it could either go out or it could just go to tape or whatever. But it's kind of it's a wish list. And you know, that's
so it's 50 grand, because you got to have the transmission kit, the cameras, and the live stream to do that.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
You got to certainly have the cameras to do the live stream, but you don't need to have the live screen. That's the upgrade. If you were to establish your priority.
Well, the live stream might be a good thing, because see, here's what happens. This TV 20 only goes on Cox. Okay, and that was my next question. Is there a way to get that on DirecTV and everything else? Or is that a financial thing? Why is that? It only is good on Cox.
It's only good on Cox because that's part of our franchise fee and agreement with Cox in order to have the citizens have Cox available. We don't have any agreements or anything with, say, UVerse or DirecTV, no. But, you know, so, and our ability to do that is,
But the live stream will allow that to happen on the web.
We could do a live stream on the web if we purchase the equipment to be able to do that. Yes, yes.
That's what I'm saying.
Because they can see that same thing on YouTube.
But it won't be live.
It wouldn't be live. Right. Exactly.
No,
so we're paying $30,000 to see it live.
50.
So a lot of these things need to be included in our list of items that we could use the sales tax extra
That's very tough. Yeah, it's yeah.
The CIP.
Yeah, CIP needs to put on that list to be considered as to where it needs to be prioritized.
Can we put all those, or can we just put a few of those?
Well, probably the capital ones. Some of the, you know, like
the cameras
and
themselves.
The music and stuff, that's background music that Aaron uses, and we, you know, we pretty much have to have it. I mean, you know, some of it's like the TMTV tech support, you know, $800. That's just a fee that's going to go to TMTV that is a part of the internal switcher that allows us to go live or just record, or, you know, and we're paying for a maintenance fee for that, which is relatively cheap when you look at what it would cost otherwise if it breaks, which it has.
So the audio for council chamber at $12,000, that's for all these mics and everything?
That was to make some improvements in here, yes.
Because I know he's always coming in.
We need improvements, yes.
Because Aaron's always, you know, when it's, you know, what do we get and all this wireless, I mean, but yes, that's what it was for.
I wonder if it's possible to get a recommendation on prioritization as well as what we could move to CIP, and if that's possible.
Sure, right.
So we don't have to make that now, but that would help us a little bit here and there, but I think we need at least some of this. It's good for transparency,
what,
it's good 50, for...
50,000 of it?
I don't know, I think based on priority, if they go and say which one's most important, and then we'll cut the stuff we don't really need at all. You know, because some of that stuff, just like they're saying, it'd be silly to get some things if you don't get other things, other items with it. So these guys know that stuff, and they can tell us, well, we need all this. If you give us 50 grand, this is what we do, or something.
Yeah, because I think we need to beef up GTV 20 a little bit myself. There, you know, more and more people are watching that.
Yeah.
Each and every week, it seems. So, I don't think 7,000 is near enough.
No, it's not. Some of it's not. Some of it's not.
Well, we can, it was requested, and come up with a prioritized list. And
workshop.
We can put what's capital and what's not capital.
Yeah, workshop it.
Okay, we talk about the general fund versus the capital improvement fund, and we talk about shifting money, shifting items to be paid out of capital improvement instead of out of general. Is everything that we talk about shifting, does it have to be a physical item that we're purchasing, number one, and number two, why is that of benefit? How come we can buy it out of capital improvement money, but we can't buy it out of our general budget?
You mean buy it out of general budget, but not out of capital improvement?
Other way around.
Other way around.
Yeah. Other way around. Because we're talking about shifting it to
capital improvement.
So,
I see what you're saying. Yeah.
But what's the magic that the capital improvement all of a sudden has this opportunity and our general budget doesn't?
Frees you up money.
Well, it has money over there. There's money.
And is it all? Is
big
the,
deal.
Is that money the general sales tax, or is that 3/4 cent sales tax?
3/4 cent. That is 3/4 cent.
And what's our limit? And we have a limit as well on that. So how close are we to that limit?
Well, we're projecting $1.2 million. That we're going to be bringing in this year. There are things currently funded in capital projects that may not no longer be needed, and so yeah, there's funds over there.
I mean, are we talking maybe potentially a few hundred thousand?
Oh yeah.
Or million?
Yeah. Okay. Probably $300,000.
I guess to expand a little bit. When we were talking about the 3/4 cent sales tax, and all of us talked constituency, did anybody say we're going to use some of that money to upgrade GT20?
I did not.
I don't remember the list. It's been a while since we looked at the list. I don't remember what's on.
Well, GT.
But I don't know that we just have to stick to
that
list.
It isn't a need.
I'm just saying, I think we need to be very careful about all of a sudden saying, well, we'll take that out of CIP.
And the mayor's correct, because you could fund your whole capital improvement budget that we historically have funded with CIP, and you've left no money then to do the projects that we wanted.
Quality of life.
So you got to be careful how much of that money you use for what we would traditionally take out of our budget, our general fund budget.
That's why.
But there is no money in the general fund budget to do those things, so. So you can use some of that CIP money, but I think the mayor's correct. You've got to be cautious how much of that you use and what you use it for.
The only thing I heard was, why can't we get it on Dish? So, but that doesn't go towards anything that we're talking about here, because that's not going to work anymore.
I hear that frequently too, Brian.
But I got another quick question on the back to the general fund, though, real fast. Is that, so, you know, we borrowed the $16 million to pay off our loan, and we borrowed an additional basically $3 million to look at a pool or whatever we're going to do on that side of it. So where is that money in the general, where is that?
It's capital projects.
So that's over capital projects?
Yeah. And it's, yes.
But my question, when I say where is that money, not just where is it on a line item, but is it drawing any type of interest? Do we have it, or is it just sitting there flat?
The $3 million?
Yes.
I don't know that we keep the interest. I think the interest goes back to the trustee bank.
Why would that be? If we're responsible for the whole deal,
I'll check for sure, but yeah. I think that's how it's set up.
That doesn't make sense, but.
I'll check.
Yeah.
Is that for holding the money for us? I mean, that's kind of steep.
We're already paying interest on the return payments that we're making, so why would we give them the interest that the money accrues while we're holding it?
Let me check.
Yeah.
Is this related to municipal bonds, or?
Should be somewhere.
Well, if it's municipal bonds, then they make the interest. That's the point of the
These aren't bonds. This is just a fund.
This was, yeah. To my understanding, it was a loan.
It's like a construction fund, is the way it's worded to me.
Is there even $3 million in it right now? And that's
So that should.
It's just sitting there.
Yeah, we shouldn't be giving that
interest. Actually, we're starting to draw down on it with the engineering from wastewater treatment plant and the little bit that was done for the swimming pools.
So what is that fund called?
The capital projects? Or
which
the,
is capital projects.
Yeah, that's okay. Where it's at currently.
Okay.
Any other questions about HR? So the next department is building services, which is also underneath Jim.
I had one more on HR. On the ICMA, again, because I'm new to this somewhat, why is that $7,300?
That's, ICMA is the retirement plan, and so that would be for me.
Okay.
And it's 10% of my salary.
That we're paying?
Yes.
Is that what everybody gets?
That's what everybody that is in the ICMA plan gets, yes. We have about 6 pension plans here, so they're all different.
Why, my understanding, and see, that's what my understanding was. My understanding was that was just a city manager deal. And again, I come from a different
it's
world.
It's pretty much just the directors. The exception to that would be Kim. When Kim started, she was in the OMRF plan. And so,
what are you in?
She stayed in the OMRF plan.
Right, where she's funding that, right?
No, the city funds that. Well, there is, the OMRF plan is a defined benefit plan. And as a part of the defined benefit plan, the employee makes a 2.69% contribution, and the city keeps the fund healthy. So that contribution to that fund changes annually. It can go up and it can go down. I've seen it over 10 per year. Basically, it's if the investments they make, in other words, if the stock market is good, it raises all ships and the contributions end up being lower, and if the stock market is down in the tubes, then we're going to be expected to pay a lot more money to keep that fund up. Mm-hmm. But anyway, that's the plan that Kim is in. The plan that I am in is actually not a defined benefit plan, but it's a what they refer to as a 457 plan.
which is somewhat similar to a 401k plan.
I just never heard of a deal where the company, so to speak, contributes 10% of a director's salary to a retirement fund.
Well, you're contributing that to police, you're contributing it to fire, you're contributing it to all the public works employees by keeping that fund healthy.
Because I think the city pays, what, 7.69%?
7.47, I think, right now, for OMRF.
For OMRF, for employees.
And then, that's what I'm saying.
And then we pay, the employee pays, or I pay 3.69.
And so since you're not a director, the director level, I just think that should just be for city manager, but.
She is at a director level.
No, so, but you're still on OMRF.
That was my choice.
Okay.
Police and fire, about 13%, aren't they?
Fire's 14.
14.
It went up a couple of years ago.
And I think it's pretty common among cities, so I think that's not something we can back off on. We've been doing that, other cities do it.
Fire and police is state law, you can't.
Yeah, I'm talking about director within the city government.
I'm just saying the directors, we've been doing it, other cities do it. I think it's pretty much a need.
Well, I think that's quite different from the private sector, just because it's a different type of animal.
You can close the fund down if you want. I mean, you truly can. And no different.
No, I just think it's, I just think it's not real transparent where one division within the government gets one program and then the worker bees get another. That's just the bottom, and I'm not ever going to change on that. Okay?
Well, it's kind of like the difference between fire and police and the rest of
union.
The employees.
That's a union, different deal.
It's state law.
Is it state law?
It's state law, it's statute.
But it's union.
But it is union, difference.
But it's not the same.
No, I know it doesn't go to the union side.
The amounts have nothing to do with the union.
Right.
I mean, I think there's just a handful of directors that are in ICMA. The rest of us are with OMRF, correct? Suzette, are you?
I think I'm with ICMA.
She's ICMA.
Is she?
You're the only OMRF.
Oh, never mind.
Everybody else is in the ICMA.
I'm with the other worker bees.
The OMRF, Bruce was in the OMRF.
So why aren't we doing this for all the people? Why do we have separate funds? Why can't we do ICMA for everyone?
Well, sometimes it depends on what plan was effective when they went to work.
Yeah, and I'm trying to remember that. Did this start with Matt Mueller? Did we?
No.
It's way back.
This was this way when in 2000 when I came here with Brett Jones.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I can't remember exactly when it started, but it seemed like it was about 2003.
Brett was in ICMA, and maybe it started with him. I don't know. Maybe that's what he was.
I don't know any city managers that aren't in ICMA.
They increased it.
That's the way it is because they move around and they don't want their retirement tied to Guthrie.
No, I understand that.
So they all are ICMA.
Yeah.
I mean, I could see if the OMRF was a bigger producing number, but if it's not, it just seems to me like, you know, the majority are being penalized 3%. What it looks like to me, because I wouldn't think that the retirement accounts are netting 10. So I'd like to talk about it a little bit more if we can at some point. And look, I'd like to see the cost, what it would be if everyone were in ICMA.
And I don't think everyone would qualify under ICMA rules to be in ICMA. That's a special fund that only certain director level, i.e. city.
Okay, again, I don't, I'm looking at just two different, two animals.
But I think ICMA has requirements, and most employees would not qualify for that program.
Right, by plan design. Just like OMRF has a CM plan, which is what Bruce was in, even though OMRF is the plan, they run the plan, that plan is completely separate from the plan that the employees are in, even though it's under the umbrella of OMRF, the Oklahoma Municipal Retirement. There's just different qualifications and there's just different plan designs for different groups of employees. It would be wonderful to have one plan and not have to administer five or six like I do.
Okay, well maybe I don't fight that battle. It just seems, just doesn't seem right. But anyway, that was my question.
Okay.
Building services.
Building services.
Building services. This is Jim's department as well. Two employees that are paid out of this department.
Who are they?
It would be Kevin and Donna. Two employees.
I think it looks pretty in the...
We took away the professional development, so is that going to be, has that been used or not? It's not being used? It's requested.
It has been used, yes. You can see 15 and what we budgeted in 16.
You know, my experience, when you start to look at tight budgets, one of the first things that gets cut is training. And I really think, personally, I think that's a bad way to go when you're looking at some long-term effect. It's not big money either way, but I think there's a message that you give to people if you say, you know, we're not funding any professional development, we're not funding any continuing education, any enhancement for you for the next year. I just think that has some real bad long-term effects.
Well, and you can move money. For example, you can limit overtime and move it down to a professional service type line item. I doubt that they would need to have overtime in the first place. Do they really?
Yeah, they do. If we wax the floor sometimes in here or over at the library, you got to do it when it's closed, it's off hours, and typically it'd be overtime. It's not, I think that's out of 2,080 hours in a year, I think it's 20 hours is what I've got in there for overtime for two employees.
Okay.
But we certainly, you know, I if you want to cut it, we can cut it.
Well, no, not if they're going to have to be after hours, can't.
Well...
Necessarily.
We put together a budget, we'll live by it.
I tend to lean toward with Steve on this one.
In that particular example, there is, you know, there I would think there would be options. I mean, you could say, next Wednesday, we're going to be closing the library from, you know, 2:00 for maintenance.
Well, let me ask you this. Under, what was their past professional development?
Well...
I can tell you, last year, Kevin went to a seminar on preventative maintenance and preventative maintenance systems and softwares for improvement.
And one of the reasons why it was cut this year is because I didn't show any, unless it was paid out of a different line item. The only time I showed any professional development was in FY15.
Yeah.
And so that was the reason.
But there's a request for 17 for 400. What was that for? Was there something specific?
Specifically, no, other than, again, probably just to keep up with general maintenance, be it HVAC or...
Anything else on, are we through with that?
How's that steel and loom, how's that keep going down? Most things go up, that looks like it's going down.
Wow.
Fuel prices have stayed down, that's what we're requiring.
Yeah, but we went from cutting FY14 to now we're, FY17 proposed $1,000, which where actual was $2,000.
I think we requested two. I think part of the thought process on the two was, as we went from, again, the one vehicle, which is our van, to we got what we refer to as the Red Ride, the Explorer that came over from the fire department, and it was placed in the building services, and that's where we pay for it in terms of, so everybody, it's a community vehicle.
So is $1,000 good enough? Is that what you're saying?
Well, it's...
Pretty skinny.
It is a little skinny, I agree, if we have to buy tires for it, which we don't, because we just bought tires, but if we did, that would eat that $1,000.
Steve will pay for them if they go bad. All right, we're in finance now, right?
Finance, yeah. This is my budget, and it includes me and one other employee, the court clerk.
Which is you?
Court clerk.
Court clerk is the...
Your city clerk.
Yeah.
Never mind, sorry.
It also, we did have a part-time position, I think, coming out of this. But we took in payroll, and I eliminated part-time position in finance. Part of finance is also paid out of GPWA. And so, three employees, I believe, come out of Maxine's.
Three in the part-time.
Yeah, yeah. Come out of Maxine's budget. And the professional development in this budget includes the clerk's treasurer's conference. There's two each year. Also, the court clerk goes to a conference. And if we don't usually go every year. We try to go every 2 or 3 years. Our software company puts on a user forum down in Dallas, and we usually go down there.
Sounds pretty normal.
The next department is the planning and community development, and that is Cody's area.
That's what you said.
And I can tell you right away, his looks like it was cut. It's because his position was moved to economic development, his salary and other things with it. We moved him to economic development.
So who's in this?
This is our chief building inspector, Jim Henke, and our community and economic development coordinator, Shelby Lewis. Both have been here 10 plus years.
Right. So you're requesting 160. Why is that?
Hold on, I'm trying to catch up. Where's the 160?
Or were you even involved in that?
That's what Buthward.
60. Did that include your salary before?
Yes.
Oh.
And then it would also have included, I believe, that request.
Yeah.
Added in a part-time employee for the window.
Yes.
Whenever, think back to 2014, we had a community development director, we had an economic development director, and of course, due to illness, we merged that position. We merged that function and lost a position. Economic development along with inspections require a lot of time out of the office. And so I just to kind of make sure that we didn't lack customer service or anything, I did request a part-time employee at the window. But it did not make it over to the proposal.
So there's no part-time person in this number?
Not in the adopted number, or the proposed.
The 90,000 Shelby and Jim.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Why is the ICMA number blank
there? Because those two employees are not ICMA retirement funded employees. They're through the OMRF. Is that right, Jim?
Okay.
Yes, that's correct.
Are you ICMA?
And I was.
And
yes.
You were, so he disappeared.
Yeah, you'll see that back in economic development, I'm sure.
The professional services, a little bit down, a little bit lower.
Yes, the 100,000. Yes.
Yeah.
You requested?
I did. I requested, we have a chief building inspector who has a very labor extensive job, climbing up on ladders, doing inspections through new developments and redevelopments, who's coming towards, admittedly, the final season of his career. We have no longevity plan. We don't have anyone
in the wings, and the amount of training it takes is very extensive. I of course came here from a 60,000 person town, and we only had one chief building inspector who was completely credentialized, who had all of the training required by the state. This 100,000 is a contracted service through the a group that I'm blanking on their acronym right now, but basically they come in and provide that service as a contracted employee on an as-needed basis. We are looking at 160 new homes and the potential for three separate 15,000 square foot developments in the next year. It's going to be very, very difficult for one inspector to handle all of those things.
Can I ask a question?
Absolutely. Real quick,
when you mentioned that, Jim mentioned admittedly that he was coming to that, you know, seasoning his career. Mm-hmm. How long do you think?
You know, honestly, that has changed so much. He made a great sacrifice in staying on with the city whenever that merger took place in 2014. I believe that if it wasn't as intense on the labor aspect, that he could at least have another 5 to 7 years with
so
us.
So why don't we hire another person and have him shadow Jim and get the on-the-job training?
And that was a thought. The contracted services at that point...
be a lot cheaper than the 100 grand.
Yes, but it was also ready to go right away.
And they're no longer available?
They are still available.
Okay.
They are
but we're going to be locked in the long term.
I'm sorry,
that
acronym is IBTS. It's the International Building Technical Services. They do some private contracts with several different cities. So I just want to follow back up
and
on that.
And that's just for inspections only?
What I budgeted was inspections only, along with they would take over a little bit of our fire marshal duties and plan review as well.
So I got a question. Where did this, where would the, was this money from before? Like where, it was a salary, but where was it? Was it in this budget? How was it reflected?
We've never budgeted for this.
Employee. This is a new deal.
This is a completely new deal.
But we had an employee.
Yes, but
we still do.
You had their savings.
Yeah.
Okay.
Still up there.
Well, I mean, I think what Councilman Wood is saying, you know, is exactly what I mentioned earlier. We had a community development director. We had an economic development director. We now have one community and economic development director. You saw those savings in budgets passed.
Right. Okay. But we're saving $70,000 for that because we lost. That's a saving.
Yes, and this
right
would
there.
Be the second full budget year that you saw those savings.
So what you're saying right now, you're community development director and economic development
correct.
Director.
Correct.
Okay. And yeah. Which one is more time consuming?
Community development, because of not only the daily work, but the boards and commissions that come along with that position. And it does hinder economic development efforts.
Exactly. We have so some positions?
This is where I was going. And so why wouldn't we, couldn't we take someone like Shelby and increase her workload, expand her job description some?
I mentioned earlier, Shelby's been with us for 10 years, so we actually sent her to our first professional development this past August to Community Development Institute in Conway, Arkansas, where she was able to expand her horizons a little bit. And I mean, yes, you could absolutely see that, but you're still going to have the demands of the construction calls that come in. Jim's out in the office. He doesn't catch every call that comes in asking for the inspection the next day. You're gonna still have to have the person taking payments and applications. You're still gonna have to have the annual dues, the mail outs and those kinds of functions that she provides. The minutes and note taking and the reporting for different boards and commissions. Sorry.
So you still need administrative?
Yes.
Well, is this 100,000, Mark, is that a soft number or a hard number? I mean,
That's an estimate for what we plan for the demand.
Could it be a little lower at all and maybe getting more of a, maybe either up the hours of somebody or get another part-time person? Does it make sense?
With what we're expecting with that English Farms development, we have a pretty good understanding of what kind of inspection demand Jim Hankey's going to have. So yes, it could be lower, but that's just an estimate for what we expect for that demand load to be over the next year.
So could that change next year?
It could. It very well could.
So,
and that's what I like about the contracted service is because you can forecast what's on the horizon. Do we have an English Farms being built every single year in this community? No, we don't.
So it could go down 60 or 70 the next year?
It could easily go down to 20.
That's why I'm a proponent of looking for maybe a lower end experienced inspector that can assist Jim through his process now and shadow to some degree so he gains that experience.
Yeah.
Then now there's two inspectors.
Yeah.
Now Jim's ready to retire at one point. We've got an automatic.
We have the guy that moved.
I respect that viewpoint. The counter to that is, do we always have to have a second full-time inspector? No, we don't.
No, but...
And I would hate to see city resources being wasted on a person who's just sitting in the office.
But if Jim's going to be retiring, you wouldn't have to.
Exactly. That's and right. You probably, the guy I'm talking about is not 100 grand.
No.
The guy I'm talking about is probably 30 or 40.
Yeah.
Well, okay, so you're looking then, 2 to 3 years.
Then with the training that that person has to go into.
$100,000 deal.
Then with the training that that person has to go into on the fly learning and everything like
but
that.
But then we have an asset at the end of the, then we have the asset at the end of the
improvement.
I think what I've seen is one is somewhat of a short-term fix, mm-hmm. and another one is looking at a longer-term mm-hmm. continuation with
you're seeing
employee.
Many.
Because what happens if Jim decides, well, it's time to go, I need to retire.
We need to have someone like an IBTS ready to go tomorrow. If Jim were to, and Jim's at training all this week, in fact, and we have not been able to complete any inspections throughout this week. And I can tell you, he's gotten at least 18 phone calls today.
And
so if we had a guy,
he'd
be out doing the inspections on Joe Smith's garage electrical.
Or in this case, or in the scenario that I presented, we don't have to have a guy setting when Jim is here, but if we need someone that we can make that call through IBTS. And they would, their response time is within 24 hours.
So I guess our big problem is we're not paying for it. It's requested, but we're not paying for it. So if we do this, we have to find
100 grand.
We've got to find it. So.
And that's for a year.
These are contracted.
That's for a... Yes.
Inspections are a big deal that we really need to be concerned with.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm not a proponent of subcontracting that out.
If you look around, though, it's becoming the standard in a lot of towns. Because of the changing requirements and the changing standards, these contractors are able to keep up on it because mm-hmm. it's all they do day in, day out. And they have the people to relieve the person going to training and do all that.
I'll tell you, in the central Oklahoma, not every single community has a Jim Hankey who is completely certified.
Maybe that's another thing. We take that for granted to some degree.
Yeah. And didn't
usually
we also
three or
pass
four.
All the? We passed all the changes in the ordinance for the plumbing and electric.
You got, yep.
So we're
you got
we're
one more
standard.
Coming on Tuesdays.
Yeah. Okay. So we're standard now, and anybody in the state should be able to come and inspect. Mm-hmm.
And I'll tell you another
us.
Reason that we put in this.
Good point.
This longevity approach is the fact that we got a huge knock on the fact that we have 4,300 different residences and we don't have anything past a one-man show right now. And so the ISO, who's in charge of our insurance rates, we lost out on points of that because we're so short-staffed right now.
So the
long-term problem that we're fixing is the fact that we need to be able to meet that demand. We need to show ISO, we need to show the customers that we can do these inspections in a timely manner.
So have we ever put it, and I don't want to beat a dead horse, believe me.
You're fine.
Yeah, because in my business, when we're engineer short, mm-hmm. we hire one. Okay, and it is common practice to sub that out as well,
mm-hmm.
but that's just not our strategy. It's way more cost effective to keep them in-house and then flip another hat on them within that engineering group when they maybe aren't
Like I said,
building switch systems.
The 100,000 is for a high demand year. We have not had a high demand year like we're going to see in 2016, 2017 in the last 4 years that I've been here, certainly. And so I don't think that that would be a consistent number in years moving forward. I think that it would be substantially lower.
But well, so at I the guess same time, you said that even with the base of 4,300 houses, mm-hmm. one person
is not enough.
Not enough.
No, but what we get whenever we contract with ISO is an organization that has on-call ready. They can pull the contractor who's in Blanchard. They can pull the contractor who's in Newcastle if we're short-staffed or if they are not being able to meet their demands as much, and they can move that over here.
So kind of like a retainer. Mm-hmm.
So the $100,000 is just a number, right? I mean, they're going to charge us hourly, or how does that work?
It's an agreement that's already been passed through OML, and so we actually would only have to recognize the agreement through a council protocol. We don't actually have to contract them every single time we have to use them.
I guess that's where I'm going with this, Cody, is that I'm looking at $100,000. I'm thinking we could hire two more people for that amount of money. Potentially. Or one for way under that for sure.
I'll tell you, if you hire two and you put those same training, you'll lose those two within 2 years. Well, you'll lose those two to another community that can.
But my question is the 100,000, all right, so let's say we use this firm on ABD project, whatever it is. How much does that cost us for that particular, like 15,000 square feet? How much does
it cost? It's $700 per inspection.
Per inspection, mm-hmm. Okay. So that's what I'm talking about.
But if you hire two people and help them with their training and they think they're going to stay and they learn to be inspectors, then the next year we don't have an English Farms or we don't have things that need to be inspected. What are you going to do with them? Pay them another $100,000
or
let
them
go?
No, you're right. No, absolutely not. I'm not talking about hiring two inspectors. I just use that for a point.
Right.
Okay. Okay. What I'm talking about is have we run an ad to hire a real qualified inspector, not a trainee, somebody that is qualified like Jim?
Since 2014, absolutely not.
Okay, so what if we did? And what if that was a $56,000 a year job? Okay, then all of a sudden, it may be worth looking into that side of the house. He's already trained, mm-hmm. he's already there. That's what I'm talking about. There may be somebody out there that wants to move to a small town, already has, you know, his career in order. And I mean, if we don't look, how do we know? That's all.
Did you have something?
Well, you may never be able to find that person.
I think it's going to be extremely difficult to find that person, number one, mm-hmm. because of the specialty required. And I also think it's going to be very, very difficult to try and train somebody to come up to speed, even if we were to take that route. And how do I say that? In years past, we have had number two people in there working, and they haven't been able to pass the test, those different
But where do we, if we haven't?
And they've been here for years and couldn't pass those tests and ultimately left the position. And so it is a very difficult spot to fill. And that's created this whole thing for outside contract inspections.
Right.
Because cities,
they know that there's a market for it.
There's a huge market for it because cities can't find, you can't find the people to do it.
Exactly.
And you can't find the people to train to do it because they can't pass the test. It's a very,
that was
an extremely difficult
test. A 1,500 square foot inspection would be around $1,100. And so with their $700 fee, we're still banking about $400 on it. That's a 1,500 square foot, typically at least two bath. We mentioned bath because that's where the plumbing comes in.
Let me stop right there a second too, because I've talked Integrity, for example. I'll just throw them right out here on the table. I've talked in detail with them, and they've got a serious issue with the fees that we charge here, and it's supposedly way more than other areas, Edmond, Oklahoma City.
I don't know if the evaluations were passed along to council, but that's actually not true. We are about $42 less for every 500 square feet than Edmond, and about $29 less for every 500 square foot inspection in Oklahoma City. Edmond's the highest. We're trailing behind those two. The way that our fee structure is broken down is based on square footage, whereas others are based on
I'm not talking new construction here again. I'm talking when you're retro. There's different inspection fees, is my understanding. I'm talking a lot of what they do is go in and do retro. Like if they're going to go in and replace an entire heat and air unit system and it has to be inspected, that's the fee I'm talking about.
We did an evaluation for integrity based on what
I brought all the that previous, in. I gave it all to Bruce.
Right. Based on new construction. We didn't evaluate based on retros.
Yeah.
But, I mean, we obviously can't.
But that's what they're talking about.
Okay. We, like I said, it was passed along to us that we needed to evaluate new construction. And that's what we did.
Okay.
Kind of interesting that the contract, well, IBTS would pay for itself and then some, but you don't have that guarantee with the employee.
True.
Yeah. Right. No, that's a that was a good question.
I just, and a good
response. Yeah. That's something that I didn't know going into this conversation.
I have a hard time looking at an employee saying, you know, if they're at a on demand basis like an inspector is, planning for that long term. Whenever we don't know long term whether they're going to actually have work to do.
But we do still have an issue. I mean, if that's what I think that you were thinking a little earlier, maybe not, is that, you know, when Jim goes and retires, are we talking about using this group full time on everything we do? You know, that's the problem that I see coming down.
Yeah, well, you know, clearly it has more flexibility.
Yeah, no
questions. For the ebb and flows of new construction. I don't know about the renos. I don't know about the 4,300 houses that are our base. And are we pretty sure that English Farms is going to be happening in the next few months?
I would bet strongly on it myself.
Just the way sold it?
Just the way that I've seen the owners start to organize their efforts. We were always told, even though the plat was done in June, that it would be October before they ever tried to pull permits. So they're still on pace.
Well, it seems to me, regardless, it seems like we need it in some level, and we need to put a pin in it and say, let's go back to it, because we gotta fund this somehow.
You know, like I said, if what happens if Jim Hankey doesn't make it through this next budget year for whatever reason? You know, he was in a serious car wreck last November. That kept him out for close to 3 weeks.
Yeah. All I'm saying is we're not budgeting for it in our current budget, and we need to find that money somehow. So we need to keep a pin in things like this and list them, say, how are we going to fund those? Those are things we need to fund.
So on just a general heat and air retrofit where somebody's got to pull a permit out and we're going to pay $700 to this company to go inspect that? Or is that a different sliding scale?
That's a different sliding scale. Yeah, okay. Because they don't need a...
Then it may be a better deal. I don't, you know, depending upon what the scale is.
So if you have five inspections in one day, it'll be less than $700 per inspection.
If it's a sliding scale, yeah.
And so in the scenario on the benefit of what you're talking about could be that all five people could come on the same day and do all these different inspections, correct?
Yeah, I mean, if they have inspectors that are industry specific, they like to make sure that all of their inspectors are across the board ready to go, kind of like what we have. But if there was someone who was only, you know, certified and licensed through plumbing or something like that, they could bring that person in. But like I said, they like to make sure that their people are across the board certified.
Now, what I'm saying is if we have five plumbing inspections that are going to go on today, potentially they could send five people.
They'd probably send one and have that person do five.
But they could, all right, well then let's use 50. I mean, where I'm going with this is that we're not going to back. In other words, I've heard tale of people having to wait weeks and weeks and weeks and weeks for inspections. If
my chief inspector gets in a car wreck and has to have major surgery, yes.
So in that case, it'd be a lot quicker deal.
If you didn't call a week ago today, you weren't getting one until next Monday.
See, that's what I mean. So you're out.
Because he's in a required professional development training Tuesday through Friday this week.
Yeah.
It's been hard. And I mean, Shelby gets the brunt of it. Shelby has to say, well, we're a small staff and he's at a required yada yada. And that person doesn't care. Mm-hmm. That until that customer of theirs is in that house or in that building, they're still on the hook for that money. That person does not care if we're a small staff or not. They just are hearing, we can't provide the service today.
That's when we need to have someone we can call on.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, and I'll throw in on my department because it falls into this as well. Mm-hmm. We've had some commercial construction. You know, chapels have added on to Golden Age. Mm-hmm. We had the Hampton Inn built. The sprinkler system plan review, the fire alarm plan review, we can't do them. We don't have licensed personnel to do it. Jim's not licensed to do it. Right. Therefore, it reverted to the state fire marshal, and they are so far behind right now. 6, 7, 8 weeks plus.
So a company Chapel like this could do it.
They can
actually, IBTS
contracted
did.
With the state fire marshal as right. of a couple months ago to help clear up their backlog.
Right.
Yeah. That's where I'm going with this is that it sounds to me like we would have no backlog with something.
No,
like
you shouldn't. And that's me talking to Michael. Edmund has done away with their plan reviewers for the fire systems. They laid them off and now they contract it because it's that much more economically efficient.
So let me ask you,
where are those people going?
We get to IBTS.
Well, let me ask you this. So how much inspection revenue have we brought in the last year?
Well, it's split up. I don't know. There's quite a few.
I believe that we, From our calculations, I thought we had surpassed our budget for the previous year.
I mean, just building electric and plumbing, I think you budgeted $75,000. You're closer to 100 there.
I thought we had brought in about 108.
And so deducting what we paid for our inspector, what does that leave us in a net of?
Your net would be close to 35, 40.
Yeah.
So it would have been a wash using this company versus our own inspector.
No.
Why not?
Because you're still bringing in $400 per inspection. You'll never, as long as our rates are higher than what their inspection fee is, you will always cover more.
No, where I'm going with this is with a person on staff or with a group on staff, okay, on inspections. If we brought in $100,000, for example, in inspections, and that person's salary is X, and out of that, we end up with $40,000 of revenue after paying that employee's salary and FICA and everything else that goes along with it, okay, then we'd have been awash using this company and not had to have the employee.
But on the flip side of that, if you have to pay this person that whole year and we don't have that much inspection revenue, then your revenue negative because you're paying a guy
right. to sit there. I guess I'm leaning towards this deal is where I'm going with this. And that's exactly what I'm talking about.
If you're busy, you've got it.
Could I just throw out something here? A lot of this is reaction to English Farms. And not all of it, but a lot of it is.
Right.
How about, I was just asking the question, are we showing the rate, the revenue side from English Farms in the budget? And Kim has told me no. So how about if we wait and see how English Farms progresses, we can make an amendment to the budget, add the contract when we see that the revenue looks like it's going to be coming in, because it should be better than a wash. We should be making some money on that.
Right.
So rather than having more dialogue about it, I think we've had good dialogue, but I think a lot of it is based upon what happens with English Farms.
Correct.
And I think we have the flexibility of amending the budget if English Farm comes on in 17 to go with the contract because it's generating revenues at the same time
That
are not also not in the budget.
Yeah.
A lot of it's contingent upon English Farms.
With that? Brian?
I don't see it contingent upon anything because really if you do five inspections, I mean, it's all a matter of how many inspections we're doing. If we've got a group on staff that's making X amount of dollars and we're doing Y in inspections and Z doesn't and it's costing us money for that or that person sitting around as you mentioned, then it's better off for us to do this deal, okay? And as a city, and just make whatever the flat rate is, whether it's 400 per deal or 150 per deal, if it's a sliding scale thing or whatever it is. And never get backlogged in inspections.
Sounds like we're in agreement.
I just had to ask the questions I had to ask because I didn't know. If I don't get the information by, so I'm not asking questions to combat.
No.
Or if you don't to lean one way or the other, but at the end of the process that I go through, my decision is we use that company and that company only.
If you don't think that I knew a six-figure addition in this would raise a few eyebrows, no, we're well prepared for it. But I brought Chief Harlow in from the very get-go on this. You know, we've vetted this. We think that this is a very strategic move on our part long-term. But no, I'm more than prepared to see a few eyebrows raised.
Yeah.
It makes total sense.
So, I mean, I don't know how we go from there to here. You know, we've got, how long has Jim been with us? We've got a loyal, tenured employee. Mm-hmm.
A very tenured employee who's also cross-trained to do a lot of typical planning development director position work as well.
Okay, so then maybe we're back over to the community development side of it, and maybe that's where he can start leaning.
And that's honestly exactly the plan. Was presented.
Yeah, but then we got another conundrum, because when he's ready to retire, which is going to be soon, as you say,
right?
Then
it's going to be a lot easier.
Fill that position.
It's going to be a lot easier to find a planning manager than it would be an inspector.
Yeah, so I would agree.
What I'm hearing you say is that you think we should be going with the contract.
Yes, absolutely.
Because that's not what I was hearing you say initially.
No, what you heard me say initially was, all you heard from me initially was a series of questions, okay? And from the answers of those questions, I came up with my direction. Okay, because I had no clue about this from the start, so how can you just say, let's go this way or that way, until you question, and you get the response, and you get details. And then at that point, I've got enough information now to know for a fact. We'd make more money with that than having a full-time inspector on staff. That's all. Because you gave me the numbers. It's all just, it's proof in the numbers.
Ready to move on.
Yeah.
So I guess that's what we could do.
So,
and then we can migrate him to the community development side.
So the consensus here is to add that $100,000 back into the budget.
Well, and that's what I was saying.
You saw your sitting there.
That's what I was saying.
I agree that we need, like.
Well, can I?
That's what I was saying. We need to put a pin in it and figure out if we can raise revenue somewhere else to, you know.
You're getting inspection. You're getting. You're charging your customer.
Basing that off.
Right.
You're charging your customer a fee for the service that's going to exceed.
It's a wash. We make money.
You're looking at an expense, but there's got to be a matching revenue, and the revenue ought to be. We don't spend $100,000 unless we make.
So you're just.
Wait. We're not spending anything. The end user is funding this plus a net gain of $400 in a $700 inspection.
You're not going to spend $100,000 if we don't have $100,000 of work to go out and expend.
Well, that's what I'm saying. You have a
zero cost base here. We don't have to budget anything for that.
Yes, but that also goes for the salaries and payroll. Who's there now?
No, that's
you have to budget an offset for it. You have to budget the income, income versus the expenditure for it. But we don't have to go find $100,000. That $100,000 is going to come naturally through Steve needing an $1,100 inspection.
I think that's what I said.
Yeah.
Well.
So all you need is a revenue column saying inspection fees, $100,000. Contract services to do inspections, $100,000. Mm-hmm. Jim's salary and Shelby's are already in the budget at another line item, so it's a wash.
And the strategy that we are taking is that we are moving into a contract arrangement for our inspections.
Well, yeah, but
that's the strategy that we're putting into place here.
We should heavily consider that, because it's like Chief just said a little bit ago, there's some sprinkler issues going on that our guy's not even qualified to inspect.
Right.
Okay, so we're going to have to pay a third party for that anyway, because we've got an 8-10 week lag on the other group coming in to even do it. This group can get it done, tomorrow, next week, whatever.
You don't have an 8-10 week lag, you have an 8-month lag right now.
That's what I meant, 8-month.
Yeah, the state, Jeff and them waited over 6 months to get their fire alarm plan.
Yeah, and that's crazy, because
they've been held up on that project.
Yeah.
For a long time.
So with this deal, they could have got at it. I wonder when.
Can we move on? This is great, but this is going to take us forever if we belabor every item like this.
No, this was a critical item.
I think it was important, but okay. I think there, we
So we can move on.
Yeah, so I will be adjusting the revenue to cover the $100,000.
Correct.
Right.
With the understanding that we don't spend $100,000, we don't bring in the revenue.
Got it.
Okay, economic development.
Good job, Cody.
Hi, I'm gonna stay on board for this one.
So what's up with this? This is a very...
It's back to being broken out, separate from community development.
So let me be real clear before we completely move on, and then I'll shut up. So if we're gonna do this deal over here, then we could migrate Jim over here on community development, and you wouldn't have to have anything to do with community development.
Correct.
You could focus all your time on economic development, which where it should be focused on in helping us grow this town.
Right.
Okay.
What I originally signed on for.
Well, this is a critical element. I mean,
it is
economic
critical.
Development, in my mind, is a critical element in what we're all about and what this community is all about.
Exactly.
And I think it's good to split it out, and it looks to me like it's got a good budget.
And Jim sounds like, and I haven't talked to him about it, but he would be willing to do that.
Hold on.
This is Cody.
I'm looking at our interim.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Okay, Jim Hankey would be willing to stay in the office and handle the community development side of it versus doing inspections.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
We might keep him longer doing that, too, because he's...
Yeah, I would agree.
Absolutely. He's admitted that already.
I think this is a good budget and a good thing to do.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
I didn't mean to be difficult, John, but, I mean, it is pretty important. It is important.
Okay.
I really mean it. Thank you very much for that support on the planning side. We really, really appreciate it.
Okay,
library.
Under economic development, I just want to show the contract labor is also CVB. That's where the CVB also falls under Cody.
Oh, the one part-time person?
Yes.
That's what that is.
Do we still have that person?
We have half of a part-time person right now. We're looking, the future of CVB was very, very fuzzy starting in May of this year. And we're going to be looking to make a more permanent solution, hopefully very, very soon.
What do you mean looking very, very fuzzy? This first time hearing this.
With the potential that CVB was going to move back to
chamber.
The chamber.
Oh, okay.
And then I truthfully didn't find out that I was going to still manage CVB until last Thursday.
Are you okay
you got
with
it.
That?
I'm on board. Let's go.
All right.
Let's do it.
Okay.
Get out of his chair. Go back to work. Bring somebody in.
Okay, so that budget, right? That budget stays as proposed then.
Yes.
Pitch? Just library.
Library. Suzette.
Suzette's in the hot seat now.
Yes. All right.
That's at the house.
And I have the mic. Questions?
How many employees you got?
7, including myself.
How many, what's the attendance per day at the library?
Depends on the day. On average, I would say between 75 to 100.
That many, huh?
On Wednesdays, I invite you all to come specifically in the morning. That library is packed with little people. On average, we get between 30 to 40 kids.
Wow.
Why on that one day? Is that
because Wednesdays is, Wednesday mornings is, what is it?
Story time.
Story time, sorry. Okay. Had a brain fart.
So these would be preschoolers that would
correct. We now have so that's the children's librarian. We have a teen librarian and we have an adult librarian, and they are going specifically for targeted groups. So the adult librarian, for example, had a cheesecake event. Over 20 people showed up. And that was specifically for adults, although kids and families came as well. Teens, when I first started, we had teens sitting outside the library. I get to work at 7. And teens were sitting outside the library just hanging. And so we are purposely trying to find things for them to do to keep them engaged.
Yeah.
Okay.
So now we're at another ICMA pension. But they've got different pensions. Oh, that's because your other people aren't on ICMA.
Correct.
Other questions?
I will
lean to Cheryl and Ed on these, if you guys would know more.
On this?
On library, for sure.
I think it looks like a good budget.
And John?
And library materials is taking a good size jump. There's a lot more.
Because ODL, in the past, the state has funded us significantly, and as you know, the state is cutting back. I spoke to a representative at Oklahoma Department of Libraries this month, and they're not confident that they will be able to offer funding. So Guthrie Public Library has existed through the state and the Friends of the Library.
So you got more than you requested in the proposed. How did you do that? Because the rest of them want to figure that out.
Probably because when this was due, it was at a different point, and since then, additional issues came up, specifically the conversation with the state.
Okay. What do you, okay.
There's about 12,000 more in salaries than.
Yeah, I'm thinking, didn't we?
Yeah,
we didn't
unfortunately, one staff member was overlooked.
Yeah.
Oh. Uh-huh.
It was a part-time
position.
So what do you use 3,000 a year in professional development for?
That's training. The last week of March, which next year will be April, the week that Kevin usually comes over and cleans the floors is when the library is closed and the entire staff goes for training. Next year will be in Norman. This year it was in Tulsa.
What kind of training? I'm just curious. I've never dealt with a library.
Oh, how do you deal with homelessness? Because we are...
So from community training.
Community stuff.
Okay.
How do you address someone who lives in your town but doesn't have an address, yet they need access to information? They need to get on the computer.
Yeah, okay.
There we go.
Okay, I'm sorry. Police is next, but we're going to skip them for now.
You got through that easy. Yeah. Look at it. Just can't even believe it.
We're going to go to...
Skip an animal control, too?
Yeah, we're going to skip police, code. Operations, animal control code, criminal investigations, police officers.
New enforcement.
We're going to go to street.
Street department.
Yeah. Criminal investigation.
Oh, that was helpful. Yeah.
01-12-0.
That's a lot we're skipping.
Well, Don's not here.
I know.
Maxine's here, and all her guys are here.
But Don's on his way, I guess, right?
Yeah, no, I don't think Don's going to make it.
So we're not going to be going through that today.
We're going to try, aren't we, Jim?
Okay, we're going to do HR. 01-12. We can do some slashing in that department.
Yeah.
I can have all communications.
Yeah. We're going to try.
Not going to show up.
Yeah.
Where is it?
Getting all money.
Streets is Maxine's group. I'll let her take over.
When we first proposed our budget, we were thinking we were going to have to build streets. So we were going to need two additional employees for that. That's why the difference in the requested amount for wages and such.
Okay. That was a part of the capital improvement, the sales tax concept of improving
streets.
Yes, is that what you're referring to?
Right. He was wanting to purchase a lay-down machine.
Do it ourselves.
Right, so we could do it ourselves. We're really not equipped to do that.
You don't think we should be doing that?
I don't. The reason, I'm always game, you know, if he thinks we could do it, we were going to try. Personally, no, I don't think we're capable of doing that unless we have more people and higher trained people for that.
Okay, but the number one thing on the sales tax citizens' response was streets.
Exactly.
Streets. How to improve maintenance of streets, however you define that, you know, less potholes, whatever. So if you say we're not going to do it in-house, how will we do that?
We, in the past, up until last year, have defined the streets through the street committee, which ones in the wards that we have prioritized, and we take that, match it with our budget, and we bid it. And we have a contractor come in. They come in and within a 2 to 3 week period, fix those streets that we have identified.
Did street committee even meet? I mean,
we haven't had a street.
No.
But we need to.
I think that's a concern.
I think I'm on that.
It's a CIP issue, though.
It is. We're right back to the same thing.
This is a CIP issue, and that would probably not really be in her budget, but it would be something that the committee would say, instead of we're doing a mile a year, let's do 4 or 5 miles a year for a while. Or whatever.
Yeah.
There's no way that we're keeping up at a mile a year.
Mm-mm. We cannot do that and take care of the events that we're required to take care of annually. We're an event city. We've accepted that, and it takes all of our people to do that. We are behind on potholes. We're behind on sidewalks, curbs, lamp post painting. We're behind on a lot of things. The street department has 7 individuals, including the superintendent.
Oh, is that all the employees on the streets?
That's it.
So how do we?
I thought there's a lot more than that.
So how do we fit? We need to fix potholes and streets. What do we do then? What's our?
Well, like I said, you're going to have to allot some money out of CIP for streets, and then contract it every year. Is what you're going to have to do.
Labor.
Right. And when the street committee allowed us to purchase the seal coat machine and the crack sealer, those items will help give life to our streets. Once we have the contractors come in and do those streets, then the next year we can put another coat of seal coat on that, and that will make those streets last a lot longer. We'll go in, and we've already started doing some of the crack sealing, but it takes our full crew to do all that. So we are limited to what we can do.
So where is that under street sidewalk bridges? Is that where that line item is to actually do the streets?
Yes.
170?
Yes, that's for repairs. That's for repairs of streets, sidewalks, and bridges.
So is that what we're talking about contracting out?
Now, the street CIP is a totally different thing. Okay. That's the user fee.
Which we estimate to be $235,000.
Well, where I'm confused at what that is.
The $235,000?
User fee for streets. I mean,
we've got a CIP that's dedicated to the streets.
Yeah.
And it does you about a mile a year, right?
And so that's $235,000, right?
Yeah. Yes, yeah. Yes.
So let me ask you this. And so we spend $235,000 a year, but not just $235,000, because we actually spend another $170,000 down here.
Yes.
Right. Right.
Right. So we're actually spending closer to $400,000 plus.
That is correct.
So how much is the machine to do our own streets?
The machine is $225,000, I believe.
Okay, yes. And then how many employees to run it?
Two. Did you say two?
Oh, we were going to add 2 to the crew.
No,
two.
I mean, in a perfect world, how many employees to run them to start asphalting roads?
We have never done that, so we really don't know how much it will take.
The estimate for the machine is $150,000.
I usually see 3 or 4 of them when they're paving roads on these machines, and one guy are using a roller behind them.
Brian,
it's
going to
take 10 or 12 people to operate that laydown machine.
Is that right?
You got to have 4 people on the machine. Yeah. You're going to have 4 people on that machine
then you're going to have your rake hands, your shovel hands behind it. Then you've got to have people in the trucks with a CDL driver's license. You're going to have people running back and forth, getting that asphalt, that hot asphalt, in those big trucks. So,
yeah.
You've got to have somebody to direct the traffic.
So it takes
both ways.
It takes several.
It takes a lot.
So if we hired five people, that would be the 12, right? Using the whole street committee to go pave roads?
If you can hire qualified people like
I'm just trying to get to here's where I go with this, and the only reason I'm asking is because when you look at the expenditure, okay, the total expenditure of equipment and annualized salaries and everything else, if it's at or less or pretty close to what we're spending on this contract stuff to do a mile a year and fix a few potholes, and we can do many, many, many miles a year, it just makes sense to do it.
When you have those 12 people doing that, everything else...
Stop. I know that. I understand.
So, you're laying asphalt. You're 300 foot in.
Yeah.
You got two trucks sitting there with hot asphalt on them. Something else happens. What do you do?
Well, if something else would be an emergency, but we have other people over here now, right? If we start jumping over... No, we don't.
No.
Your total department is 7.
I
just keep thinking it was a lot more than that.
You're talking about public works?
Yes, public works. That's
They have line maintenance.
Yeah, so you got a whole public works side where there's a lot more people involved that maybe you'll take care of accidental stuff, maybe?
Yeah.
Or not? No?
Sir, no.
No way.
No.
So
they're doing water and sewer.
They're doing water, sewer, everything
water
else, and that's
sewer,
not going to happen.
They're not qualified.
And they're behind.
And they're not
so
qualified.
The point is that we're talking about contracting out. That's all going
to
be contracted.
So it's a capital expense we'd have to spend. We'd be spending a lot more than the $400,000.
And we haven't been doing that. We haven't been contracting out?
We haven't. Not this last year. We didn't do anything this year.
But normally that's what we do.
Normally that's what we do.
Use your contract out.
No, but realize the biggest thing on the CIP that the reason we passed the tax, the number one thing is
right,
the roads.
Is to do
so
the roads.
Technically, we could spend a big chunk of tax dollars to hire the people and bring these people in and increase this line item by 3 or 4.
Okay? Well, if you use some of the tax dollars to add to the street CIP, then we could.
Employees are not capital. Salaries are not capital items.
No.
Wouldn't the streets be?
The streets
are a capital item at the end of the day. We got dirt roads all over this town.
I'll look at it. But
and if it's asphalt now, it's a capital item.
Here's the thing. Well, the asphalt's not the problem. The machine's not the problem. The salaries are the problem.
I know, but in order to get that cap
so we could contract out with CIP.
Couldn't you give us a list of streets you wanted and use some of that money to contract it out on the list?
Yes.
That's what I'm saying.
Contract out can be totally CIP.
And there are no cities.
That's my point.
No cities in Oklahoma do their own paving.
That's another thing I didn't know.
If you give us a list of streets, then we can move forward on that.
That's why everybody's a contract.
The streets committee needs to meet.
So what was the reasoning behind Bruce wanting to do our own streets then?
I really don't know. I really don't know. Because I tried to explain to him. But, you know, if he told me that's what we were going to do, he was my boss, we were going to give it our best shot.
Yeah, I think also when you take non-recurring funds, and this is our tax, our 3/4 cents is sunset, right?
Right.
And we make commitment, hire people. We don't hire them for 15 years, right? We hire them for as long as, you know, we've got money. You can't do that. I mean, that's a bad way to start.
Okay, I'm good.
That's a bad way to start. So, but I do think that the streets committee needs to help identify what the priorities are, and then we spent a goodly chunk of the sales tax, 3/4 cent sales tax money on getting our streets going.
On top of the CIP fund we already have identified, out of the fee, the user fee, on top of that.
So that would put a big chunk of cash towards getting a bunch done.
Couldn't we put, move this 170 over to CIP and open that up?
Well, this 170...
Or even a portion of it?
That's Councilwoman, it takes in potholes, it takes in gravel, it takes in repairs to the brick streets, it takes in the curbing.
So no, you couldn't.
But we could do some of that.
It's a lot of maintenance. It's just maintenance.
A lot of the small materials. Not the big overlays.
But some materials. If we're trying to find money, we could at least put a percentage of that for materials and things, could we not?
That's not a capital improvement, though.
Well, I mean, we're talking about the actual tar, and we're talking about the actual part of the road.
Well, if you have the 3/4 cent sales tax money and part of it goes to the streets, you'd be better off by giving us a list of how many streets, how many miles of streets you want and which ones, and then bidding it. Because the contractors, they're set up with all of the equipment, and they would be able to, you know, get in here and get it done. Whereas if we do it, it may go on and on and on.
Yeah, yeah. No,
it makes sense. The 170 is for the maintenance after the contractor gets it done.
That's right. Yeah, that's
fine.
Correct.
So, I mean, and you said you asked for us to give you a list, but you guys already graded all the roads as to which ones are really bad.
Well, normally what we bring to the street committee is we have a priority list, and we take that and get your approval on it and move on that way. So what we would do is give you a list, and then if you have any changes or anything to add, then we would take your what you all want us to do and incorporate it in however you want it to take place.
Mm-hmm. And there's some things that the county and the city both have half of, like going to Liberty Lake, for example.
A lot, just like we're working, I've got a interlocal agreement into Kim right now on the Fairgrounds Road with the county. We're going to do a, we'll buy the asphalt, they'll lay it down for us. And we've done that on several things.
What about the Liberty, the lake and all that? Because there's a lot of developmental opportunities out there.
I'm working on that. My wildlife, the Oklahoma Wildlife Department has told me to ask for a grant for that road.
Awesome.
So I've got that in my
toolkit.
That would be awesome.
Yes.
So on the CIP, when we get to the CIP, we need to talk about how much we're going to put in streets, how much we're going to up that, right?
Exactly.
Well, I think we need to know what the priorities are.
Yes.
I think the street committee needs to meet with the input from Maxine and her staff and identify, here's the priorities, and then we figure out how much we can do.
Well, that's a good point.
Part of my thought was we need to probably put an upper limit on how much we're going to say we could do in the streets, if that makes sense. So it fits the budget. We can't say, well, let's do $10 million. That's the priority.
Using the whole
There is an upper limit of what we can do and do all the other stuff we want to do. And I think that might be part of the strategic planning is to figure out what our priorities are, because if we want to do another $1 million in roads, well, that means we can't do this and this in our priorities.
Well, I think we are going to be talking about the CIP and workshop also.
So who's on the streets committee? Do we even know?
Yes.
If you're not on the budget committee or finance committee, you're on the streets committee.
I'm not on either.
No, I'm on finance.
Oh, you are?
It's me.
I'm on finance.
We haven't been meeting, so some of these new people I've never met. So
I have no idea.
Well, Bruce didn't want it to.
Bruce never called a meeting. It should be me and Jeff Taylor and...
Yes.
Ed, probably.
And Ed.
Ed. It's supposed to be one per board.
Yeah, because me, John, and Cheryl are on finance, but we never meet. Yeah.
I have an issue. We can meet.
Good.
Yeah. The streets are going to meet.
We get to have a meeting.
Yeah.
Another meeting.
In your own finance. Okay. All right, well, you're good.
That's
I guess.
We're moving on to fleet.
Got through that easy enough.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So who's in the hot seat here now, fleet?
Oh, fleet. My helper's back here. Got my little elves. We have three people in this fleet maintenance. And that just pretty much reflects it.
Yeah.
Three people.
How come, jumping back over to streets real quick, you know, the one thing I had circled with a question mark was the $40,000 in vehicle maintenance. Because fleet's doing all that, right?
Well,
is that maintenance just parts and liquids and all that? Would it be, albeit oils or?
I pulled that out of their accounts individually throughout the month. It's an account that Kim kind of takes care of through my department.
Okay.
It's charged back. In other words, it's charged back.
I pull out of police, fire, just whoever I happen to be working on.
Right, I see.
I pull from that account.
Yeah. So if you got to rebuild a tranny, that's coming out of that money.
Exactly. Yes.
Okay.
Is that billed straight hours or is that flat? Just out of curiosity, how do you bill for it? Just straight?
We don't.
You know.
We're
just whatever
it is. Whatever parts of cost is.
It costs what it costs. Yeah.
Are you guys pretty busy all the time? Just
All the time.
It's mold vehicles, so.
Yes. Still.
Well, and I think all of us are a big believer in fleet maintenance for sure.
And they also take care of anything like the dozer.
Take
care of some mowers, you know, just from the smallest to the largest.
I mean, it's nice to have warranty on everything, but we don't and we never will.
No.
So.
No.
I don't have any questions. I have no questions.
Nope. Let's move on.
Thank you.
Moving on.
Thank you.
Cody should have put his stuff at the end. He would have avoided all those questions.
Yeah.
Parks is next.
Parks.
Okay, let me see where we are here.
Well, that's a fashion thing right there.
Overtime.
Yeah, overtime's a big thing. It's a huge thing.
Why is there so much?
Okay.
I don't know.
Okay, screw. What do you
come sit over here, Blue?
Is that winter time?
We have how many? Eight. We have eight.
I have several full-time people, and I got two seasonal people with me right now. But we have events starting from April all the way to October.
Yeah.
Okay, with the addition of Red Brick Nights, a lot of these events will cause you to work on Sundays.
Better audio in this room.
They work 7 days a week.
But a lot of it is due to the increase of events that we didn't had. Another example is the funerals that we do have. A lot of times they're late. Like we had one yesterday, it was 1 o'clock church. The arrival time was 4:20. My guys left at 6 o'clock. So when you add up all of the events and then with the funerals and stuff like that, that kind of increases our overtime. But part of it is due to trying to keep a full staff. Where we did our seasonal help, it just haven't panned out.
They don't want to work.
So it's easier to just go overtime with a seasoned guy or gal versus worrying about a part-time.
Like we had 6 employees budgeted for seasonal help. We have 2. And even out of the 2, one might give you 4 days a week. But it's just part-time, the seasonal help just hadn't worked.
Yeah.
And that was part of the reason I asked them for 2 additional full-time employees, do away with the seasonal help. Because you need people you can depend on.
So that do away with the overtime then?
Not all of it.
Not all of it, but it would cut it down.
But the seasonal help's going to cost, you're going to increase money with the employee.
Yeah,
it'd be more than.
Be a wash.
But they might be more dependable, though.
But, right, and I say this, people you can depend on, you're going to be able to get more done. We did lose an employee for 8 weeks this year, you know, the back surgery, so that throws you behind. We lost another employee for 5 weeks, so we had 2 people all doing the same time that that work team still had to try to keep everything done and keep these events ready and going, trying to maintain your parks and cemetery. And what you're doing, you're trying to keep everything up, but all it does is throw you falling farther behind. So you kind of need some people that you can depend on and count on. And when you knock out two people, so now you're down to a five-man crew. And you're trying to take care of parks, you're trying to take care of lakes, cemeteries, ball fields, right-of-ways, plus events.
Plus, you got to do all the mowing around town and everything else.
Yeah. Yep.
That's...
So do you have enough in this budget to get done what you need to get done, Blue?
Probably not, because we went way over this year.
We went way over.
I noticed your request. Well, that's what I'm saying. I noticed your requested is 40, 50 grand higher than your than the proposed.
I have a question for Kim related to what's it's a hotel tax as part of this. So how much? What's the hotel tax revenue for parks?
It doesn't go towards this.
Oh, I thought it went to money for parks.
It goes towards
now we got a new cemetery.
Equipment.
Parks equipment?
Yeah.
Parks just equipment.
We had it out.
Yeah.
We had it out.
How much is parks equipment? How much is the hotel tax going to this for the hotel, the equipment? Yeah. Is that not in here equipment?
No,
it's
like
we're
going
to have to get Cody out there to bring some more business in town or something.
Where is he?
Oh, I thought you were out there bringing a business in.
So,
well, I was.
We're projecting 64, around 65,000.
Okay.
But that would go towards. Yeah.
Just beautification.
It also, we use it for the lake improvements, park improvements.
And we've got to be sure that we have enough to include for our match for our wildlife grant,
mm-hmm.
which is for the restrooms and for the road.
Yeah.
I'm going for both of them.
That last line there, machine equipment maintenance. Looks like a couple years ago you're up closer to around 30,000. You got this less than 20,000.
Okay, part of that is due to we did get two brand new mowers last year, and that helped us out a lot. But what it is, our machines are trying to maintain so much ground, and a lot of them say it's like right of ways. If we had a tractor with a bat wing, we can take care of them wide areas, them back slopes and stuff with a wide area machine. You're going to save, you're going to extend the life on them lawnmowers.
Yeah.
We're trying to roll big areas with lawnmowers that really takes a tractor.
Mm-hmm.
And sure. So what you're doing is you just basically run out a lawnmower before its life is up.
Okay.
I mean, like, just like the flat, you're looking at 80 acres, them little lawnmowers are taking a beating, they 5-footers.
Didn't we get a new tractor? Didn't we
That's
approve
for
a new
the
tractor?
Street department. That was for the
That's
street
for
department.
That's for ground
then
construction.
It's totally
That's
different.
A different type of machine.
Yeah, that. But
I had
mentioned to Kim that where the asphalt the laydown machine was in the budget in the CIP, if we could take a portion of that money to get Blue the tractor he needs. We've already got a new bat wing, and
you do have a new bat.
Yes, we do. Mm-hmm. We
so you don't need the mower part whatsoever.
No, we just need the tractor.
How big of a tractor?
It's about an $80,000 tractor.
So you need a 100 horse type tractor?
Yep, like 110.
Something
point
like
100
that.
To 110.
And that's right? And then fleet, everybody agrees with that one, I guess?
Yes. Because if we don't do the laydown machine, which it makes sense not to, then we could do that and that money could go back in for something else.
That speeds you up 100%.
Right.
Yes, it does.
You know, it won't cut down weeding time, but it's going to cut down mowing time, like on my highways in half, and the flats in half.
Right.
Wow. At the lakes, it's going to cut it down in half. Because that tractor's 15, the mower is 15 foot wide. So it's what the 5-foot mower trying to do, that's doing what three of them mowers is trying to do. It's going to cut a lot of time down in
cut a lot of maintenance time, too,
yes.
Fleet maintenance
yes.
for fixing the tractors or
yes.
the lawnmowers.
Yes.
So you think it'd take 100, 110 horsepower to pull that?
Yes. The tractor we've been using.
With the new tractors out there, it should be a lot less than that.
Well,
we've been using a 1967 tractor, John Deere. 1967, it had to go in the shop. We spent about $7,500 out of Tenny's budget on it, and they never did fix it.
Yeah, but I got a 42 horse tractor that would pull that bat wing.
pull it for very long.
Right.
Well, is that what it is?
Right.
Yeah. So that's what the deal is. Yeah. Just tear it up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I can see the point. You're using it every week, too.
Right.
Every day, it almost.
So you got to make it easy on the tractor.
And it'd be a wide wheelbase. That way it can climb the hills and stuff like that and do everything you need to do.
Yeah. That tractor will give you actually more utilization in the off-season, too, for other things.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
I mean, depending on what you would.
Well, you put a loader on it. You'd have to load it.
Yeah, you'd have the loader. Or
could we lease one of those, or?
Not really. You just buy that.
It's like, you've already used it so hard.
But you're saying it's like, what, 80 grand or something like that?
Yeah.
You'll write a check for
but,
that.
But you're going to be using this year-round. And I give you an example. Is like when we go into the fall season, we have to clear our dams. We rent a FECON that costs anywhere from $4,000 to $4,500 for a week.
And this tractor would.
This tractor's going to do most of that.
So see, we come in here to cut the budget, and we're jacking a lot of cash onto it.
I'm giving you back some. I'm giving you back some.
Get rid of an asphalt machine and get a tractor and say.
How much was that machine again?
It's around
$80,000. The lay-down machine?
The lay-down machine. No.
$225,000.
And how much is this tractor?
$150,000. $150,000. Oh, I'm sorry. The trailer involved in there.
Yeah.
We do the tractor.
The whole thing. Put it on.
I was going to give you back that too, and Tenny told me we needed that.
I think it came from your department.
We needed that trailer.
Yeah. We need a motion.
For safety reasons.
All right. So we done the park?
With an emergency clause.
You may do a lease purchase on that and not have to do 80 grand out of the budget.
That's true.
That's true.
A lease purchase.
Yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we could probably
can
do that.
Can you check into the tractor and see how much we can get that thing done for? So we can maybe workshop that thing coming down the road?
But, I mean, it's important that we're talking about this, but we really need to talk about the CIP.
Right.
Items in a separate workshop.
Okay, because that is a CIP item.
Yes.
Okay, that's fine.
But yes, lease purchase.
Yeah,
but that's something I can see you all really need back. The city would benefit greatly.
So I don't have a problem with any of this budget. Does anybody else?
Mm-mm.
Z, you good with this budget?
So far.
Yep.
You?
Yeah.
So we can move on.
So far.
Thank you.
Thank you, Blue.
Appreciate it.
Thank you, all you do.
I guess we're waiting for police.
Pool.
The last item, pool used to be in GPWA. We moved it to general fund because years ago.
See, Blue can use his new tractor with the front end loader to fill in the hole.
Yeah.
But I mean, we can get rid of this whole thing.
It's anti-pool.
Now, my grandkids would have a fit because they swim in the summer.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's nothing different about the pool the way we have it arranged.
Machine and equipment maintenance.
Well, most of the pool mechanisms are new. They were done year before last.
I got a question. I'm confused a little on the request and proposed on the, because everything adds up except for there's a line item that's different. Would they add up differently?
Which one? I'm sorry.
Okay, so machine and equipment maintenance is 1900 versus 2500 requested. Nothing else? Oh, I see 600. I just missed that. 600.
Yeah.
Administrative charges and what?
Yeah.
Why is that? What's going on there?
Yeah.
They increased it just last year on us when we asked them to stay or to open on a couple of holidays.
This is our contract with the YMCA.
Yeah.
Okay.
And that's the reason why that's different is because that $600 was not funded.
All right.
And so I stole it from the other line item.
I see.
So we're on break now till police come. Well, we got.
Well, police. Yeah, police is not going to be here.
We got airport.
We can move on to. Can we take a minute for
recess?
Sure. Yeah, we can take a break.